In this video, we're looking at a block sitting on a level surface. It's being pulled by an 80 Newton force up at an angle of 35 degrees above the horizontal. And this block experiences kinetic friction as we drag it along the floor for 5 meters. And the point of this problem is that we're going to use the work and energy approach to figure out the final speed of the block. That's actually the last part of the problem. And all the steps in the problem just kind of build up to that final calculation of the speed of this block after it's been dragged for 5 meters. So we start in part A with a complete force diagram for the block, including all force components. And the way I'm going to start the force diagram is by actually showing a force vector for the tension in this string. So we should be clear about the fact that that's a force vector. All right, so next we're going to decompose that force of tension into its x and y components. And I just called those Tx and Ty, but we'll go ahead and get some numerical approximations while we're at it. Ty is going to be 80 times the sine of 35 degrees. And when we run the numbers on this to 3 significant digits, we get 45.9 newtons. So that's the part of that 80 newtons that's pulling up. Tx is going to be 80 cosine of 35 degrees. And that gives us 65.5 newtons. So next we'll get the force of gravity into the diagram, and that's given by mg. And if we sub in the mass here of 8 kilograms and a g of about 9.8 meters per second squared, we end up with a force of gravity of 78.4 newtons. So now we do the normal force. And note that I've just left the normal force as an n for now because we don't know what it is. It's not equal to mg. And the reason why is that we have another force tampering with the vertical direction. That's Ty. What the normal force does is whatever it has to balance all the vertical forces on this block so that it doesn't sink into the floor or jump off the floor. So we'll get to the calculation of that in part B, and I'll post a link at the top to a video that clarifies when the normal force is not equal to mg. So our final force to get in the diagram is just the kinetic friction force opposing the direction of slipping. And we'll just leave that as an Fk for now and then plug in the details later. So let's get into part B now. We want to compute the normal force on the block. And this comes from a vertical analysis of all the forces. I know the acceleration is zero perpendicular to the floor. And this means n plus Ty, that's all the upward forces, must balance all the downward forces, and that's just mg. So staying symbolic for just a moment, n is going to be mg minus Ty. And this makes it very clear that n is less than mg in this case. And the reason why is just that the upward component of the tension is helping the normal force out. So the normal force doesn't have to do as much to balance the weight. So now we can sub in our numbers, and we have 78.4 newtons for mg. We have 45.9 newtons for Ty, and we end up with 32.5 newtons for the normal force. Next, we're asked to get the friction force on the block. And so this kinetic friction force is given by the coefficient of kinetic friction multiplied by the normal force, which we just computed. So if I just sub in my coefficient of kinetic friction, that was given in the problem as 0.33. My normal force then is 32.5 newtons, and I've got my friction force, which to 3 significant digits turns out to be 10.7 newtons. Okay, so basically parts A, B, and C, we're about getting the force diagram completely nailed down and getting the size of every single force. And in part D, we start in on the work energy calculation. So I want the work done by tension and the work done by friction. So I can start with the tension here. And the work done by tension, remember that's just going to be the parallel component of that force multiplied by the displacement. But the parallel component of the tension, we already have a name for that. That's Tx. And then I'll go ahead and call the displacement for now. We'll just call it delta x, but we know it's 5 meters. So we just sub in Tx, that's 65.5 newtons, and a delta x of 5 meters. And note the units here come out to newton meters, but those are joules. And to 3 significant digits, I get 328 joules for that work. Now, when we're looking at the work done by friction, we see that the friction force is already anti-parallel to the displacement vector. The displacement vector points to the right, friction force points to the left, and this is going to give us a minus sign. So we end up with a negative Fk times our delta x. So that's negative 10.7 newtons times 5 meters, and we get this negative work of 53.5 joules. So there's friction doing what it usually does, which is to remove energy from the system. Now in part E, we want to use the work energy theorem to find the final speed of the block. And there's one point about the setup for the problem that I want to highlight here. We were told it started from rest, which means the initial kinetic energy is zero, so we don't have to worry about that. So we know the net work gives us the change in kinetic energy, and the change delta always means final minus initial, so that's K final minus K initial, and K initial happens to be zero. So the net work is just the work done by every single force in the problem. The normal force and the force of gravity don't do any work because they're perpendicular to the direction of motion. That's why I didn't ask about them earlier in the problem. The only forces doing work are tension and friction, and we already figured out how much. So the net work is going to be the positive work done by tension, that's 328 joules, plus the work done by friction, but that's a negative work, so minus 53.5 joules, and that's going to be equal to the final kinetic energy, which is 1/2 times the mass, that's 8 kilograms, times the final speed squared. So I'm going to run the numbers on this all at once in my calculator, and just for the sake of full transparency, that 328 joules for the work done by tension was actually 327.5. So I'm going to keep the extra precision while I run the numbers. And to three significant digits, I end up with a final speed of 8.28 meters per second. So one of the cool things about moving into these energy methods as we progress in a physics course is that you can always go back and check your answer with the old methods. So I encourage you to check that you get this same answer of 8.28 meters per second by just using Newton's second law directly. So what I want to do is look at the net force in the x direction. That's from Tx pulling to the right and Fk pulling to the left. Use Newton's second law to find the acceleration and then solve the kinematics question of how fast you're going if you accelerate at that rate for 5 meters. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.